Everybody, a very warm welcome to everyone joining us, whether you're joining us from near or far. We want to welcome you this morning. To those of you who don't know me, my name is Genevieve. I am wife to the legendary Brent Nell, mother to three children, and a member of this beautiful family we call Freedom House. And it's an incredible joy to be with you this morning. Excuse me if I bob around a little bit, but I'm actually feeling super excited about everything that God has in store for us. And I want to just encourage you this morning with a scripture that's been a huge encouragement to me over this time that's been quite uncertain and a little bit yucky and all of the rest. But it comes from 2 Corinthians 12 verse 9, where Paul is speaking about this jolly thorn in his flesh. And I'm sure he's frustrated, he has had enough, he's at his end. And God says to him, "My boy, my grace is always more than enough for you. And my power finds its full expression through your weakness. So I will celebrate my weaknesses. For when I'm weak, I sense more deeply the mighty power of Christ living in me. So I'm not defeated by my weakness, but delighted. For when I feel my weakness and troubles surround me on every side, I am made yet stronger. For my weakness becomes a portal to God's power." Now, if that is not good news, I don't know what is. It means that when we are weak, it doesn't necessarily mean we are powerless, because we can choose to tuck in. We can choose to make the resting place of His love the source of our lives. And in that place, it is incredible, because God can actually take our weakness and show His glory in and through our lives. And so this morning, I want to encourage anybody who's feeling weak, where your hands are feeling limp, you're weak at the knees, you're tired, you're done. That is a wonderful place to be. Let's surrender to God in that, and let's allow Him to show His power in and through us. And we get to encounter this incredible love, this beautiful, incredible love that God pours out into our lives day after day. Whether we fail, whether we don't, He's always pouring that love out. He is always pouring out into us. He never runs dry. His love is never not enough. It's always more than enough. And that's what we get to encounter day after day after day. And it's not dependent on our state of mind. It's not dependent on the state of our hearts. It's dependent on His faithfulness. He is faithful. He is faithful to deliver us. He is faithful to lift us out of the miry clay. He is faithful. That is the God that we serve. And so I'm going to stop talking, but I want to pray that you encounter that beautiful love this morning. And so God, Abba, we just want to be where you are, because that is the safest place to be. God, we thank you that it is you who pursues us. You, the lover of our soul, we only love you because you loved us first. And that is an incredible truth, Lord. It means that we can lean back. We can rest. There is no striving in your love. You ask us to abide. And that if we abide in you, that fruitfulness will flow out of our innermost being. And so this morning, we don't want to try harder. We don't want to do more. We just want to abide. We want to rest. I thank you that our greatest fruitfulness, God, comes out of a place of resting in you. And so we lean back. Just as that beautiful song says, we lean back into the loving arms of our beautiful Father, for you are good. You are good, and there is no love like yours, God. So we thank you for this love. Let us encounter you this morning, Lord. Amen.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Freedom House. Wow. Anybody else feeling a little overwhelmed in every good way by God's presence. Can I hear an amen, please? I need you to work with me. Come close. Shuffle in. Snuggle up. Talking about those out there, you can also come close for those of you that are here in the shed. Yes, it's me. My name is Ryan, and I'm wanting to be like Tom Selleck as springtime approaches. I can feel spring is coming on, hence my shirt. Thank you, Debbie Carey, once again for spoiling me. And I think that every man that is able to grow a mustache needs to start moving in that direction. Bring back the 70s, baby. Bring back the 70s. And I want to give a shout out to all the Gunners supporters. Well done, Arsenal. Well done in winning the FA Cup. And yeah, next year, try and catch us Liverpool supporters. But I'm looking at Yuck there. Good man. God bless the Gunners in Jesus' name. Oh, well, what is the time? Will someone tell me when it's 10 o'clock? Fabulous. And then that means I've got another half hour to wrap up. It's a real treat once again to be with you. And I share this very honestly with you. You think you are missing us. We are desperately missing you. We're into the fifth month. Honestly, to be fair, I never thought that into the fifth month we would still be meeting like this. And to be quite honest with you, I'm struggling not to be with you all. And what holds me on track is that it's only 4 or 5 months. We've got a little time more. We have to see this period through. Beautiful Freedom House. We need to stand true. There is such a temptation to abandon all the important, loving, respectful protocol and get sucked into casualness. No, no, no. Let's not do that. Let's hold true to the things that we need to do, not because we are anxious, not because we are scared, but because we are loving and we are kind and we are mindful of those around us. And yes, there are moments when I feel like I have it clear, moments where I feel a little overwhelmed. Maybe it's just me and Tom Selleck, but I want to encourage you, stay true, stay strong, keep your mask on, wash your hands, simple things. The fact of the matter is the Matthews clan, over the last 5 or 6 weeks, we have come close to the coronavirus through no doing of our own. You know, we've had 4 tests in our household last weekend. You know, we had to isolate as we're waiting on a result, not because we were being silly and casual, but because this is what we're going through. It's not out there, it's close. I'm just sharing our story and our journey. Parts of my family have had it, and I want to encourage you. This is a real thing. No, it's not going to end how we are going, but it is real. So I'm encouraging you to stand true, stand strong, and let's see this through. Are you with me? Does everybody agree with that? Absolutely. And if you don't, bless you anyway. The things that we are doing as a leadership team is because we want to see this spike through and get on to the other side and look to celebrate together as we're able to gather as the church in time. So God, great grace on every heart where frustration lingers and confusion abounds. Thank you for grace that brings clarity in Jesus' mighty name. Tonight, let's move on. We are in for another treat. We have Unlocking the Kingdom, and we have the one and only Sydney Jolson. He and I are going to be talking at length about some good stuff. We're going to share some stories of what God has been doing out there. There are so many good things that God is doing. And make no mistake, be careful how you baptize yourself in the news. Be careful how you are baptizing yourself in the information that is coming your way. There are many, many good things. And tonight we're going to share some good stuff people coming to faith, being healed, being delivered, incredible strategies of heaven, touching the deepest parts, not far from here, lives being changed. I'm looking at Jane right now, Jane Armstrong, who works and spearheads the North Coast Courier Fund, what they are, Orphan Fund, what they're doing into the deep parts. I think of Summerhill, I think of Ngubonga Resource Center, and the many others that are doing such good things. That's just touching the surface of how the men and women in South Africa are so convinced that the little things that they do go a long way. Keep loving people. Every time you go to the store, love on each other. Be kind to each other. Encourage each other. Ask each other, how are you doing? Stay strong. Stay strong. Okay, the little things go a long way in the kingdom of God. Okie dokie, I'm ready to rumble. Psalm 23, can you turn in your Bibles to Psalm 23? I have, for the last number of weeks, felt many things stirring in my heart about what to speak about. There is no lack of hearing the voice of God and how He wants to speak. The wisdom is required to just shape it accordingly. Today, I want to just press pause for a moment on the important understanding of how we are called to renovate society. We're going to keep going with that in weeks to come. We've got some good things that we are going to do, because we are going to come out of lockdown and we need to be a strong, courageous bunch of people called believers that love and serve in society and renovate every sphere of influence that we find ourselves in. But today, I want to speak from Psalm 23. And I have to admit, yesterday, as I was just allowing the Word of God to wash over me, I was repeatedly being overwhelmed by the loving kindness of God. And I want to read this to you. I'm reading from the NIV. And by the way, this is my new Bible. It's so lacquer. That's the Greek word for super kiff. And that's the Durban word for it's very nice. It's beautiful. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. Let's just sit in that for a moment. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters, and He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the paths, the right paths, for His name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the very presence of my enemies. And You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely Your goodness and love and kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Wow. Don't you just love that psalm? It's incredible. And make no mistake, the team that was leading worship this morning, and even the stuff that Jen was stirring in our hearts this morning, they weren't sure of what I was speaking about today. And so much of what we were worshiping through this morning is found in Psalm 23. I want to walk us through this and speak to you like a dad as we endure this time, as we navigate and walk through these challenging times. I want to remind you that Psalm 23 was penned by David. David the shepherd and David the king. This great, ruddy, six-packed, ripped, pectoral, pumped, bicep curling David, who takes down giants. This great David who, you know, lops off the head of enemies. This great David who takes on lions and bears and cheetahs and tigers. Well, I don't know about the cheetahs and the tigers, but the lions and the bears. This incredibly powerful David who had a love as a shepherd for the sheep, who enjoyed worshiping while no one was watching him. This David who became king, who was chosen of God, this David upon whose throne the true David, the great King Jesus, sits. This David, this shepherd, this king, Friends, this David is equally a sheep. I want you to remember that. In these times where we feel overwhelmed, in these times where we feel like we need leading, it's okay. We don't have to be the giant slaying, lion taming, bear beating up king. It's okay that in life to be a sheep. It's okay. If you feel overwhelmed and you need leadership, you need guidance, you need someone to take you by the hand, this is what Psalm 23 is all about. So the first verse is the summation of everything that will come from this moment. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. And this is the truth, that when the Lord is our shepherd, we truly come into a place of lacking nothing in life. That is an important reality and truth that you and I need to hold on to. But the connection, the important understanding is this: we come into deep satisfaction when the Lord is our shepherd. Make no mistake, that is an important reality. The Lord is our shepherd. Now, I want to point out some really important things to you. In your Bible, when you're reading, you will see when you read the word Lord, it's in capital letters. Can you see that? It says Lord. The name that David is using here is Yahweh. Yahweh. The first time that Yahweh revealed himself, God, our God, David's God, your and my God, revealed himself as Yahweh was when he looked down upon Israel in the deep bondage, the overwhelming situation they found themselves in Egypt, where Pharaoh was not being a Pharaoh and he was being ruthless and demanding and commanding that they would do much more and go above and beyond what they were able to do. They didn't have the resources at their disposal. They were being run ragged. They were being beaten and bruised and overwhelmed by an unfair Pharaoh. And Yahweh looks down and he calls Moses to deliver them. It says in this moment that Yahweh looked upon his people in distress and was concerned and full of care. And he came down to rescue them and deliver them. This is the shepherd that David is talking about. He isn't talking about some shepherd. He isn't talking about just any bloke that is a shepherd. He's talking about Yahweh, that is the shepherd, the God who watches over his people, who is more concerned about their well-being than they are themselves. And even when they are not crying out to the God who loves them and cares for them, he still steps in to deliver them, to confront every demonic power and overwhelm the forces of darkness, holding them in bondage, to deliver them and send them on into the inheritance. That is the shepherd that David is talking about. It's Yahweh, friends. The same God who not only delivers them and leads them out by their hands, laden with silver and gold. It's the God who sees them into their inheritance. The same God who walks through the very desert of life. And in the midst of it all, he provides for them. When they have nothing to drink, this God provides for them. When they are cold, he comforts them. He is the cloud by day, protecting them from the harshness of the realities of life. And a fire by night to warm them when they're feeling the chill of the reality of a desert period. He's the same God that says, you can take on the giants that seem to be overlords and protectors of the promised land. He's the same God that gives them grace to conquer the strongholds of Jericho. He's the same God that opens up the swelling rivers as they step into their promised land. Friends, the Lord, Yahweh, is our shepherd. He's my shepherd. He is your shepherd. And David says this Yahweh is my shepherd. He takes personal ownership, this intimate connected space. Yahweh is my shepherd. But I also want to say this. Not only does it speak of personal connection and relationship, but David had to come to a point of choosing that he would follow this shepherd. Are you with me? This is really, really, really important. In these times, in order for us to live in a place of not lacking anything, we have to take a decision that we will follow no other voice. We will follow no other leader. We will choose in these times to follow Yahweh, God, as our shepherd. And when we make that decision to abandon our self-subsistence, to abandon our secular humanist need to look after ourselves and to throw ourselves, as Jen says, vulnerably transparently upon Yahweh, it's then that He leads us and we lack no good thing. Now, this is where we need to move. We need to understand that this great shepherd Yahweh, who leads us to the extent that we lack nothing, He leads us in all times of our lives. Verse 2 and 3 speaks about how Yahweh is shepherd in the good times. In verse 4, it speaks about how Yahweh is our shepherd in the dark times. In verse 5, it speaks about how Yahweh is the shepherd of our souls when the enemy is assaulting us in wartime. Look at that. God isn't just our shepherd when it's all going okay, and we lack nothing when it's going okay, and all things are equal, and the river of life is meandering, and the sun is shining, and the birds are tweeting, and we are just loving life. Not only do we lack nothing in those moments, the good times, but when Yahweh is our shepherd, when we choose Him to be the leader of our souls, even when we face the dark times and the war times, we lack nothing. And some of you are saying, Ryan, how does that make sense? Let me show you how He does it. So let's look at the good times. Are you with me? I need some help this morning. You are super quiet. Can somebody say amen for my sake? Barry, I can't hear you back there, brother. Amen. Amen. Let's look at the good times. Even in the good times, friends, even in the good times, God is meant to shepherd us. I want to say this. If you truly want to understand where your heart is, when you're in good times, who you choose to be led by reveals the longing of your hearts. It's easy that when everything's going smooth and cruisy and life is hang ten, baby, it's so easy to be led astray by all sorts of things. It's in those moments that we say, God, You're my shepherd. And this is how He does it. Look at this. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Look at that. He makes me. There are times in our lives when everything's going easy, where we want to have a pit stop in any moment and any place and graze. And He purposes to take us by our hand as wee little sheep. And He says, no, 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 there is a food, there is sustenance for you found here. I don't want you to just graze on anything. I don't want you to be resourced by just anything. It's the green pasture that I know is good for you. He leads me beside quiet waters. It's really interesting. And I give a shout out to Kenneth E. Bailey, a great Middle Eastern, ancient Near Eastern theologian, a wonderful believer. I remember reading one of his books years ago called The Good Shepherd, where he goes throughout the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, and he speaks about how God reveals Himself as this glorious shepherd. And yes, he does speak about Psalm 23, of course, but he points this out, that sheep, apparently, how amazing is this? They couldn't just drink from any stream of rushing water, fast-flowing streams. They could only drink properly from quiet waters. That water in the river that would create a little nook, and they would come and they would bend over and they would just drink like little sheepies drink. They couldn't drink from flowing water, fast-flowing water. It had to be quiet waters. Isn't that incredible? When life's going easy and life's fast-paced, we think that we can stop off in the spiritual McDonald's and just drink of anything. No, no, no. That's not where we are resourced from. It's when we pull aside and we slow down and we begin to drink slowly. Where we pull aside, we Michael Jackson, and we just press pause on all things and we drink deeply with God. We lean back into the loving arms of our beautiful Father. That's what happens when we are led by the shepherd. He says, okay, slow down. I don't want you just to eat of anything. I don't want you to just drink in any place. I want to lead you. I want to make you. And I want to lead you to the quiet waters. And that's where we are refreshed. I wonder, friends, if a lot of our lack of refreshing is because in the good times we have developed unhelpful practices of just feasting on anything. On McDonald's chips, you know, on Coca-Cola. Yuck, that's not good for our soul. We develop bad things. And in these moments, as we are led by our shepherd, he is pulling us aside. And look at this. He guides me along the right paths. But look, he makes, he leads, he guides. In the good times when we think we are the main knows what count, I want you to understand something. If we are to live in the satisfied, lacking nothing life, friends, even in the good times, even when things are going aright, he is our leader. What is this call to? Very simple. I've taken a moment to just paint a little bit of picture. This is the call. This is the call to surrender repeatedly before the God who leads us with great care, with great kindness, mindful of what we need and how we need everything in life. If we are to be led by the shepherd, it is a repeated choice, especially now, to surrender, to throw up our hands and say, I am merely a sheep. Yes, like David, I might be this great shepherd king and I'm strong and powerful, but I'm yet still a sheep before my shepherd. And his voice is what counts in my life, in the good times. But then life, friends, it's not only about the good times. I just love the frankness of this journey. It's not about the good times alone. There are many moments when it feels like all hell is breaking loose. And we go into these dark moments. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Friends, your rod and your staff, they are a comfort to me. Look at this. Yahweh, our good shepherd, isn't the one who is just with us when it's all going okay. In fact, he becomes ever more present in the darkest times. This is just so beautiful. Can you see the use of the personal pronoun? I mentioned this a number of weeks ago. In the good times, we have this ideology, this theoretical reality. It's all going good and God is with me, but the personal pronoun spoken of there is he. It's like, he's there, he's personal, but he's one step away and he's speaking to me, but I'm surrendering. But when it gets dark, guess what? The personal pronoun moves from he to you. He becomes even more present. That is just wonderful. I don't know how many times I've spoken to people in their walk with the Lord and everything's going dark and scary and overwhelming. And they say, where's God? Where's God? And he's here. I want you to know, he's even more near than we could realize in the darkest moments. In fact, I want you to know something, that he is the one that leans in. 10 o'clock, thank you so much. 10 more minutes, I'm nearly done. In fact, he is the one that never abandons us. He is the one that leans in. He is the one that even when we are throwing our proverbial rattler and toys out of the cart and we're going, God, it's dark. I thought it was supposed to be all nice, this Christian gig. Who are you? I don't like you much. He is the one that never takes the cue from our, you know, tantrums. He doesn't take his point of departure from our frustration. He leans right in and he says, my boy, my girl, I am with you. That's amazing. He's with you. And he doesn't take his cue from what we are doing or what we are feeling. You must know this, that all of this thing called walking with God as the good shepherd is undergirded by grace, grace, grace. Can you say that with me? Grace, grace, grace. What does that mean? God does not pull back when we are feeling frustrated in the dark times. God does not pull back when we are feeling like he's to blame. He doesn't pull back. He doesn't take his cue from that. He takes his cue from himself. And he knows more than anything, Ryan, right now, he needs me. And he leans in. I'm thinking right now of Genesis 3, where Adam and Eve were just, you know, nanas, you know. And they just were just nanas. That's short for banana. And they just were nanas. And they're hiding from God. And I'm going to allude to this in a moment. And they crawl into a bush and they're covering up. And there is God in advance calling out their name. Adam, Eve, where are you? Not as if he didn't know where they are, but he was speaking throughout creation that even when you blunder and even when you wander, God is not the God that throws up his hands and, you know, dusts him off and says, I'm going to drop these cats. Who are they? They're just useless. No, he leans into your life. He leans into my life and he begins to call. And you know what's so amazing? That even in the blundering, wandering moment of Genesis 3, deep inside the heart of Adam and Eve and all of creation and all of humanity throughout all of time, and you right now in that dark moment is a resonance that says, I'm made for the good shepherd. I want the good shepherd. I need the good shepherd. Without him, I'm just hiding away in a bush. You know what the sheep would do, apparently, is when they were scared, they would become bleating and quivering, but they would look for the nearest bush and they would run head on into a bush and they would hide away in a bushel and they would bleat and quiver. Bleat, bleat, quiver, quiver, bleat, bleat, quiver, quiver. That's what sheep do. When the dark times come, they just go into the bush. They hide away. It's like when you're kids and you close your eyes and you think everything's gone away. That's what they do. I can't see you. That's what we do as sheep. Bleat, bleat, quiver in a bush. And this is what our good God does, our great shepherd Yahweh. He leans into the bush before we are caught by the wild animals that will rip us apart. He leans in the dark times. He pushes in, and that's what God's doing to you right now. You might be bleat, bleat, quiver, quiver in the bush, hiding away, blundering, wondering, feeling, you know, like God's abandoned you. I promise you, he is our good shepherd, and he's leaning in, and he's saying, come, come on, come. I will fear no evil, even though I walk. Look at that word, walk. We do not crawl in fear, and we do not run in fright. We walk because he is with us. He is with you. And this is how we walk. Your rod and your staff are a comfort to me. What does that mean? That rod is not to take the nearest sheep, bend him over at his knee, and give us a good smack on our, you know, our rump. You know, good old lamb rump. He doesn't, that's not what the rod's for. The rod is for protection. And the crook, okay? Your staff, his staff, pulls us back into line. This is how we walk with the Lord through dark times. He defends us and protects us even when we are bleat, bleat, quiver, quiver in a bush. He is doing stuff way above and beyond what we could ever imagine. I'm so excited. I can't wait to get to heaven. And he plays the tape, the DVD or the VHS or whatever we remember, you know, and he plays the tape of our lives. And we look back how many times the good shepherd has been beating things off even when we are blaming him. He uses his rod, but then he also brings a staff and he corrects. Friends, as we walk through dark times, the rod is to protect and the staff is to correct. God's going to be correcting you. He's going to be pulling you here. No, 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 this is how you walk, Ryan. This is how you walk, especially Melissa. This is how you walk. Come on, come on. This is how you walk. That's how we walk through the dark times. And in that moment, that's when we lack nothing. In the dark times, he is with us. As I come to a close, verse 5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. I love this. Again, in those times, it would be a servant. Listen to this. It would be a servant who would prepare a table. And guess what the good shepherd is doing right now? He, the very creator of the galaxies, is setting a table before you in the moment of war. Look at that. He is serving you and I in these moments. Not only is he speaking to us in the good times, and not only is he near to us in the dark times, but in wartime, he's serving us. He knows it's going radical. And he comes alongside and he says, come, I want to serve you. I want to prepare a table. And then he does this. He takes our face and he says, okay, look at me. How many times have you and I grabbed our kids under pressure? They've just hurt themselves and they are giving it welly. And we just say, hey, look here. Look into my eyes. And they begin to calm down. If you feel like you're at war, the enemy's assignment is against you and overwhelming you. This is what he's doing. He is serving you in these moments. He is not lording it over you. Listen to me. He's not lording it over you saying, pull it all together, Ryan. Pull it all together, Melissa. Come on, put your shoulders back. He knows when we're at war, we're at war. And no matter what our training, we are taking a shellacking. And he comes alongside and he serves us. But he grabs us by our cheeks and he says, hey, look here, look here. When he serves us in this moment, he's not being all polite. He is talking with a firm, clear voice as only a daddy and a mommy can do. And he says, hey, look here. Ryan, right now, your enemies are surrounding. Look into my eyes. And as sheep, we must respond. And in that moment, how does he provide for us such that we lack nothing? In wartime, he pours out his anointing oil. Look at what it says. You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. It says of Jesus that he will give the Spirit without limit. Who is being spoken of in this moment? The Comforter, Holy Spirit, who comes alongside to serve us, that grabs us by our face and he says, hey, look at me. And then he gives us power, not by might or power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Not by power, your own feet of arms and your strength, Psalm 44, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. And in all of this, in the good times, it is his voice, and he calls us to surrender such that we lack nothing. In the dark times, when we're scared and bleating and quivering in the bush, he leans in with his presence and we lack nothing. And in war times, Holy Spirit comes alongside and he serves us and he grabs us by the face. But he says, hey, 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 look at me. And he gives us power, limitless power and grace abounding in these moments. And in all of this, we lack nothing. There is never a moment in our walk with the Lord, coronavirus, influenza virus, HIV virus, quaking, shaking economies, that we lack nothing. Why? Because Yahweh is our good shepherd. He is our shepherd. But this is the call. Will you let him be your shepherd? Will you simply be a sheep? Strong man. And altogether, woman, will you surrender? Will you surrender and be a sheep? And this is how it closes. Such good news. Surely, for the sheep, going through the good times, the dark times, and the war times, surely goodness and love will encapsulate and follow us up all the days of our lives. You know what that means? That even when all of hell is spewing its mess on us, it is God who works all things to the good who love him. This is the guarantee that even when you are getting shellacked at Bastogne overlooking Foy, and even when the enemy is spewing his violence against you, and even when the darkness of life is surrounding you, this is the guarantee that when God, Yahweh, is your good shepherd, he is working in spite of your circumstances. He is working in spite of your faith level. He is working that you would be followed up and surrounded and hemmed in by his goodness all the days of your life. Whoa, it's good news. My goodness, this is Such good news. That means that even when it's all falling apart, there is one weaving his goodness and his grace that would be for his glory and for our goodness. Romans 8, God is working all things, even when you can't see it. And this is equally true, that in this life, not only is goodness giving us a good old hug, but this is the truth. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My destination is glory. My destination is glory. That no matter what this life holds and how God weaves his glorious goodness in all of the stuff that I go through, make no mistake, the summation of the life, my life is not now. The summation of my life is the fact that I'm made for glory. Eternally dwelling in the house of the Lord. The Lord, Yahweh, is my shepherd. I lack nothing. I want to talk to you as I close. Believer, will you be as strong and as capable as you are? Will you be a sheep led by the shepherd? Right now, will you surrender? Right now, will you let him lean into your life? Right now, would you let him take you by your face and look at him? Will you let him lead you? Because the extent to which he is the good shepherd is the extent to which goodness surrounds you. And now I want to speak to anybody out there that doesn't follow Jesus. I do not know how you are doing this. Let me tell you something. Christianity is not a crutch. It's a jolly wheelchair, but I'm telling you, there is no one on the face of the planet, no matter how much money they have, that says they can do this life. We all need the good shepherd. You right now need the good shepherd. You need him. Can you surrender? Lay down your life to the good shepherd, and he will lead you in all of life. In Jesus' mighty name, his grace is upon you. His presence is surrounding you. But will you let him lead you? In Jesus' name. Can we stand together in our homes? I want to just bless you, and I'll hand over to Jen. Word of encouragement, man. Jesus, you are our good shepherd. You are our good shepherd. You are the greater Moses that has come down to rescue us from the pervasive Egypt. And you've led us in a great exodus. And we want to say to you, you are our shepherd. Today, this morning, we declare that we are wonderfully loved sheep. And that you lead us through the good times, the dark times, and the war times. And we give you thanks that you are faithful and true through all of that in Jesus' mighty name. But this is what we choose. As believers, we choose to surrender. We choose to humble ourselves and say, God, no matter how good we are at things in life, we are merely sheep. We choose to be your sheep. We choose to be led by you. And for those out there that maybe aren't believers just yet, today is your day. We throw up a little sheepy paws. We throw them up in the air and we say, oh, good shepherd, I need you. I can't do this. I can't do this anymore. Today, I choose to be led by the good shepherd. So, God, we ask that you would come and rescue those that are caught in bushes. Would you come and release your rescuing power, your great grace that takes us by our face and says, look at me. I bless you, Freedom House, in the mighty name of Jesus. And Jen, why don't you come and join us as we close? She's going to mention a few things.
Thank you, Ryan. Thank you for such a beautiful word. And friends, I trust that you are encouraged today. That you are encouraged that we have a God who is the author and perfecter of our faith. It is him who does the work. We just need to lean in, surrender, and trust in him. So thank you, Ryan. And we would like to encourage you today to join us. There's a group of people who have been praying for you. There are about 8 people who are wanting to pray with people for specific things today and for non-specific things. So if you are feeling like you would like to respond to the word today, please just click on the link. It's been sent through to our encouragement groups, to the leaders group. There's a link on our Facebook page. Please, I'd really like to encourage you to click on the link, log in and let some beautiful people pray with you today to encourage you. There were two specific words. As they were praying this morning, they felt that there would be some people who are maybe at a crossroads needing to make important decisions, and they felt that they wanted to impart wisdom from the Father today to you. And then for others who are just feeling really disconnected and who are really desiring intimacy with the Father, they would love to pray for you too. And for, like I've said, even if it's non-specific, they would just love to be encouraging to you today, and they're waiting to pray with you. So please log on and have a beautiful week. We pray that you would be conscious of the Father's beautiful presence with you, and that your heart would be nourished by his love as you walk with him this week. Bless you all, Freedom House.